Praise to the Lord the Almighty. Amen for that. Welcome to Cell Chapel this morning. All of you who are watching on the TV and those in our healthcare center, we are glad that you tuned in this morning. I have one announcement. On the 31st, we were having a hymn sing as part of the morning service. That's next Sunday morning, and we want to know your favorite hymns. And so we're going to include the top 10 favorite hymns in the service that day. So to know your favorite hymns, please send your hymn request directly to Jonathan Knoll at extension 33404, or call the operator and ask for Jonathan Knoll. Or you can send him an email at jknoll@masonicvillages.org. The deadline to submit your request is today, so hopefully you'll have those in. It's always good to come together in the presence of our God, and it's good to come together as we watch together and worship together and join our hearts in one accord. So in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, let us prepare our hearts and our minds for worship this morning. Receive with joy the calm and quiet of worship. Come with hope to this celebration of salvation.
Surely our God will speak to us here. We come thirsty for springs of living water.
Come as stewards of God's mysteries. Gather as servants of Jesus Christ.
Surely Christ will feed us with living bread. We will be clothed with garments of righteousness.
Be ready to receive more than you ask. Be ready to give more than you thought you had.
God will equip us with everything we need. We will learn how to live in God's realm. Amen.
And now we will sing our hymn, When Morning Gilds the Skies, number 111. One thing we can say about the human condition is that within all of us, in our hearts, there lives light and also darkness. And so today we have the opportunity to come before our Lord and ask forgiveness, for he is faithful to forgive us. Let us join now in our prayer of confession. O God, we confess that we have not fulfilled the trust you have given us as servants of Christ and stewards of your mysteries. Our possessions have become more important to us than your approval. We worry a lot rather than trusting you and seeking to be good citizens of your realm. We ask you to forgive us and draw us back to you. We beg you to free us from false gods that enslave and from limited visions that diminish the high potential for good that we have received from your hand. God, we ask your forgiveness for these and all things. Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
We serve a God who not only gave his begotten Son for us to live eternally, but we serve a God who cares about our shortcomings. We are loved. We are forgiven. Let us be at peace.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, each and every day we put one foot in front of the other, walking out our journey on this world. We ask that you make it alive in us the assurance of eternal life, that what we do here is not the end, but that we will continue to move forward, upward and onward, and one day be in your everlasting love. Amen. Our psalm for today comes to us, our psalm reading from Psalm chapter 62, verses 5 through 12. Hear the reading from the psalm. My soul waits silently for God alone, for my expectation is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be moved. In God is my salvation and my glory. The rock of my strength and my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before him, for God is a refuge for us. Surely men of low degree are a vapor, and men of high degree are a lie. If they are weighed on the scales, they are altogether lighter than a vapor. Do not trust in oppression, nor vainly hope in robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. God has spoken once, twice I have heard this, that power belongs to God. Also to you, O Lord, belongs mercy. For you render to each one according to his work. Here ends the reading from the psalm. Thank you, Susan. A good reminder of God's presence. At this time, let us join together in affirming our faith by reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come again to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Our Father's God, to the author of liberty, to thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom's holy light. Protect us by thy might, great God, our King.
Our epistle reading for this third Sunday after the Epiphany is written in the book of 1 John, the second chapter, the 15th through the 17th verses. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. And let us join as we sing through twice, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God."
Thank you.
I was talking to someone this week about how this year has been so different for almost everything that we do. But you know, some wonderful things really have happened. This virus has made us try to find other ways of doing things that we're used to doing, but we had to do in a new way. I tell you, I've done so many Zoom meetings that I'm almost hoping I don't ever have to go to a regular meeting again. It's a whole lot easier to sit in front of my computer than have to go anywhere. Of course, I miss our time here together at church, but I've also learned to use YouTube, and I found a lot of neat things that I never would have ever seen. Another innovation I saw was on New Year's Day. One of my favorite things, and something that I continue to say I hope I could get to do one day and I'd love to see, is the Rose Bowl Parade. Now, this year they did a compilation of all the years previously, and they broadcast that, and if they hadn't shared that it was from years before, I might not have even known that it wasn't done live. And I remember watching the Macy's Parade on Thanksgiving, and that was done a little differently. And even the Elizabethtown Christmas Parade was done in a different fashion. Who would have ever thought to park the floats and let you drive by? After all, I don't know about you, but I love a parade. Well, our text today calls our attention to another, but a more sobering parade, the parade of life, the pageant of this world. For the present form of this world is passing away. Now, the words passing away are a translation of a Greek word meaning to lead by. It suggests the picture of a parade of soldiers being led past a reviewing stand. Look at them. Notice the evidence of their manly strength and skill. But then in a moment, they are gone, out of sight. And so it is with this world, says our text. There it is, but watch, soon it will be gone. How foolish it is to put all of your time and energies into something so transitory, so temporary. Friends, do you realize at this moment you're not the same person you were when you got up this morning, even if it was only a few minutes ago? Ever so unknowingly, you have changed physically into something quite different. This pulpit, solid as it is not the same pulpit that I stood in on Wednesday. It has diminished ever so slightly. And if we were to see it 100 years from now, it would be less than it is now. And you and I and the whole world move inexorably toward the same finale. That's the message of our text for today. At the cathedral in Milan, there are three large doorways. Over each one is a splendid arch, and on each is an inscription. On the left is carved a wreath of roses with the inscription, "All that which pleases is but for a moment." And over on the arch to the right is a sculpted cross accompanied by these words, "All that which troubles is but for a moment." But over the great cathedral entrance in the center is this inscription, "That only is important which is eternal." What wisdom to take with us in the early days of this new year. All that pleases is but for a moment. All that troubles is but for a moment. But that which is important is eternal. I want you to take another look at those couple verses this morning. The present form of this world is passing away. That suggests at least three things to me during this Epiphany season. To begin with, this season is a good time to consider the serious implications of living. Dear people, this pageant of life which we find ourselves in is the real thing. I don't know how many of you participated in high school or college plays or musicals, but you remember how the rehearsals went? Things kind of moved slowly at first. Not many took it very seriously. There was lots of fun and horseplay going on. And then as the opening draws near, the rehearsals take on a more serious tone. And finally, the day arrives. This is it. The audience is there. The play goes on. This is the real thing. And so we need to be remindful that life for us, every moment of it, is the real thing. You and I aren't in a dress rehearsal. This is it. And this is the only life that we have. We don't have a second time around. God grant that each of us take a look at life with sobriety. Life is real and God is real and death is real. I think most of you know I'm a big sports fan. I remember reading an article narrating the life and the times of Max Baer. Some of you may recall Max Baer was a heavyweight boxer in the 1930s. His name was familiar to all who were lived in that area. Max fought Max Schmeling from Germany and Primo Canera of Italy and the great Joe Louis. And for a short time, he was the heavyweight champion of the world, which was quite an achievement. But when he retired from the ring, he had a series of heart attacks. He lived his life apart from the spotlight, and on that day that he died, he was sitting on the side of his bed when he suddenly gripped his chest with severe pains. He put his hands to his heart and he said to his wife, "My God, this is it." And in a moment, he was gone. How quickly life comes and goes. This is it. This is our life, our only life. Who knows what the day will bring with it? May each of us live under the sanctifying influence that only that is important, which is eternal. And secondly, this season is an appropriate time to discriminate between what is essential and what is merely the scenery, the secondary things in life. We have a big church word for that. It's called adiaphora, if you please. Those things that don't matter so much. Some years ago, someone coined a phrase that I think expresses clearly what I have in mind. The phrase is, "We're majoring in minors." And I think it aptly describes the person who spends a major share of his or her time on minor issues and leaves undone those things that are essential. Clyde Widmeyer was a very successful wholesale grocer. He wrote his own epitaph before his death, and he had it chiseled on his tombstone. This is it: born 1884, a human being. Died, he didn't have put in, but he had a wholesale grocer. And when he was asked what it meant, Mr. Widmeyer said, "I was so busy selling groceries that I never had time to get married or have a family. Here was a whole area of my life crowded out by business. I was so busy selling that I never had time to do any traveling, even though I had plenty of money to do it. I was so busy selling that I never had time for community service or religion or social or political activity. I was successful. Men said I became a well-known and wealthy wholesaler, but I was so busy making a living, I never found time to live." He was majoring in minors, and it's an addiction which so many of us are inclined. This is saying to us, major on majors, minor on minors. Discriminate, distinguish between the vital and the trivial, the important and the inconsequential. Our Savior showed us that when he laid down his life for each of us, that we were not trivial. We were essential to the purposes of God. As one has put it, we were so important to him that he was willing to go to hell for us rather than go to heaven without us. And so he traveled without hesitation toward a cross on a hill outside Jerusalem. And because of that, we are his debtors. And a final thought comes to mind. I don't think you did, because as I've talked to so many of you, no one makes New Year's resolutions anymore, because we know we don't keep them. But let me just suggest something to think about this new year. Resolve to become involved, genuinely involved in the things that really matter. Someone came to Horace Traubel once and asked, "What can I do? Just me. Just me." And this was his answer. "What can I do? I can talk when others are silent. I can say persons when others say money. I can stay up when others are asleep. I can keep working when others have stopped to play. I can give life big meanings when others give life small meanings. I can say love when others say hate. I can say every man when others say one man. I can give myself to the Lord of life when others refuse to do so. Will you join me?" And for the record, many did join him, and their life was enriched because of it. Perhaps maybe some of us can resolve today to join their company. I have a pastor friend who has an interesting custom, one he's followed throughout his ministry. On the Sunday closest to the new year, he gives all his parishioners a small pocket calendar in their church bulletin. And at the close of the service, he says this: "Soon the Lord will give us the gift of another year. It contains 12 months, 52 weeks, 365 days, 8,760 hours. What are you going to do with them?" Something to think about. We've already used a small fraction of the year of 2021, but most of it still lies before us. What will we do with it? Perhaps we can reflect on these two New Year poems that have challenged the heart of God's people. "O year that is going, take with you some evils that dwell in my heart. Let selfishness and doubt with the old year go out. With joy I would see them depart. O year that is with, O year that is going, take with you impatience, willfulness, pride, the sharp word that slips from these too hasty lips, I would cast with the old year aside. O year that is coming, bring with you some virtue of which I have need, more patience to bear, more kindness to share, and more love that is true love indeed." And this final little prayer: "O Lord, I pray from this day I may not swerve by foot or hand from thy command, not to be served, but to serve. This too I pray, that from this day no love of ease nor pride prevent my good intent, not to be pleased, but to please. And if I may, I'd have this day strength from above to set my heart in heavenly art, not to be loved, but to love." Somehow these words remind me of that central arch over the entrance to the cathedral at Milan, and these timeless words carved above: "Only that which is eternal, Only that is important which is eternal. Let us carry those words with us throughout this year. And may our life never be quite the same. Will you keep me company as we move on? Amen. Thank you, Susan. This is the day that the Lord has made, and it is wonderful to see you rejoice in it. So thank you very much. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Most holy God, as this is the day you have made, may we think about using it for you. Let our meal not be the most important part of our day. Let reaching out in love, sharing a word of kindness, caring for one another, may that consume us. We ask that you would touch us, that we might realize that we are only here for a short while, and that there is so much that we can do to reach out to one another simply by making a telephone call or sending a card or letting someone know that they are cared for. You do not ask us for much, only to love as you love us, to forgive as you have forgiven us. And so may we be your faithful followers, and may we find joy and the things that are important. Lord, we pray especially again this day for all of those who need our prayers, for the sick and the lonely, the hurting, for the grieving, for the lonely. Lord, we pray for all those who are devastated again by this disease, by our country that seems divided, by our own hearts, which sometimes are breaking. May you touch us. May you hear our prayers. For you know what is in our hearts and our lips, even before we say it. And so may you hear us now. As we pray together the words that you have taught, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us join in our closing hymn, The Summons.